आजादी की जंग लड़ने वाले मेरे दोस्तों, आजादी चाहिए तो उसकी कीमत खून देके चुकानी होगी। तुम मुझे खून दो, मैं तुम्हें आजादी दूंगा।
आईएनए के बागी फौजियों पर अंग्रेज देशद्रोह का मुकदमा चलाएंगे।
उन तीनों के बचने के चांसेस कम हैं।
This trial and its judgment will be remembered throughout history.
Welcome to this episode of Eureka. We are going to have a very interesting discussion about a very important challenge that our country is facing today. When India became free, we were about 33 crores of population. Today we are crossing more than 120 crore. One recent estimate say that about 8 crore of these people are homeless. And if you include people who have inadequate housing, the number would be enormous. We need to provide at least a roof above everybody's head if we want to become a developed country. That's a major challenge, and we are right now in an institute of CSIR, Central Building Research Institute at Roorkee, and we are going to have a wonderful conversation with its director, Dr. N Gopalakrishnan. Thank you, sir, being with us. Before we continue our discussion, let's take a quick look at his brief profile and we'll have a very wonderful conversation.
Buildings and structures are an important symbol of civilization. In this, scientists also play an important role by discovering safe structures which can fight against natural calamity. Dr. N Gopalakrishnan is one of the outstanding structural engineer who is working in this area. Dr. N Gopalakrishnan is presently the director of CSIR, Central Building Research Institute at Roorkee. Before joining this institute, he was a scientist at the Advanced Seismic Testing and Research Laboratory of CSIR-SERC in Hyderabad. Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan has obtained his BE from the College of Engineering, Gunde, in 1984, followed by M.Tech in the Indian Institute of Madras in Structural Engineering. Later on, he obtained his PhD from the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. His professional career started as design engineer at Tata Consulting Engineers in Bangalore. After that, he joined CSIR-SERC as Scientist B in 1987. There, he also played a vital role in the design and construction of Earthquake Engineering Division, also called ASTAR Lab. His area of research interest includes structural dynamics and earthquake engineering, machine supporting structures and soil interaction, and reinforced concrete structures. Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan has co-authored 70 international and national journal publications and has been credited with the prestigious Ramaya Prize for the best publication for 5 years.
Thank you, sir, for being with us, and it's a wonderful opportunity for us and our viewers. Let me start with a question that I ask many people who come for this interview, which is, like, you have more than 30 years of research career. Suppose if I ask you, list me three interesting work or important work or work that gave you satisfaction, you know, what would you list them as?
I would list one of the projects which we have done in an earlier institute I came from, Structural Engineering Research Center. There was a turbo generator, there was a power plant, essentially a power plant, which produces electricity. It's a 210 megawatt, that's a typical 210 megawatt power plant, which run into problems. It was not able to generate electricity because there were some vibration related issues, thermal related issues, and all those things. When you look at the outage or the cost that you spend, when you go without a power plant, a 210 megawatt for a day, it is equal to 2 to 3 crores of rupees per day. That's the amount of units, 6 million units, 5 million units are being generated, but then the cost is so much. And the indirect cost is a lot of industries go without production. So it's actually a very critical problem. One of the units, which is a unit 6th in the Raichur thermal power plant of BHEL gave the machinery to them, had a large vibration problem, and we need to solve them in as quick as possible. It should have been solved yesterday. That's the kind of problem that comes to us. And we were working on that, and we had really no clue as to what is actually giving the vibration. Then when we started looking at what are called as the signatures, signatures are like your health signatures, ECG and that kind of things. The signatures gave us, when it took from the turbine rotor, the rotor that rotates, there were actually two peaks that were coming in the vibration signatures. We are trying to figure out what are those two peaks due to that.
So it's something like, for example, if you have malaria, your fever will have some spike. That's how you understand that it's malaria. So you are looking at the vibration peak and then you got two peaks. Please.
These two peaks looks like a very innocent kind of peaks which were lying on the signature, were indicative of the proximity that one of the peaks is lurking very close to the operating frequency, which is the 50 hertz. You get the power supply for an Indian home at 50 cycles per minute. In the North America, it is actually 60 cycles per second. This was actually very close to 50 hertz. And we thought that there is a lurking resonance running nearby. And then we need to solve that. So that actually, a very innocent kind of information gave us the clue that how we can go about doing that. Once we solved that, we are trying to add some mass, remove some mass, add some stiffness, remove some stiffness. And one of them, it actually is done by trial and error. It is simulated onto a computer thing also. And whatever be the results of the computer is matched to what is coming from the field, and then put the solution into the computer thing so that the solution that is actually practically adopted also will work. That's a kind of strategy. And once we adopted that strategy and this peak started shifting away, we had clues that this will come down. So we thought that the particular hood of that particular hood is a cover of the rotor can be increased by 1.5 tons. That's all that the solution given. And the vibration amplitudes came down drastically from 200 microns to 50 microns. Okay. This helped that particular machinery to be on rail. It got into production, and that helped BHEL to back the next 7,000 crore award for Unit 7. Otherwise, they would not have got that award. Like that, there are many indirect things which have gone into making a big change in the...
Very interesting. So this is one work where you had a very practical challenge which had to be done within a very short duration, and then you have been able to successfully solve it. What would you list them as second?
The other one that I would tell is the establishment of the earthquake test facility at Structural Engineering Research Center, which was one of the India's foremost facilities. It was South Asia's largest facilities. Once we have established, because it was actually funded by Board of Research in Nuclear Sciences. Mm-hmm. They were suffering from embargo, and that actually helped us. That's a blessing in disguise for us. There are two things that were blessing in disguise which are bad things. One is the earthquake at Gujarat. This was a bad thing, but it helped a lot of money flow into research. We had the funding from BRNS, and that has to be established in a very quick time, such that some of these nuclear related issues like the 1-2-3 agreement can be done very quickly by India. How do we stack all those spent fuels?
Okay.
Spent fuels are those rods which come out of that thing after they have done their life. They still have another 500 to 1000 years of life. They have to be kept. They may not be useful, but they have to be guarded. Then how they can be stacked? This decision. Or how a control and safety rod drive mechanism can be inserted into the nuclear thing. And what is the drop time? When during an earthquake, if a nuclear reactor has to be shut down, you require very little time for the insertion of this control and safety rod. You require a very small time. So some decision has to be taken on that, whether it is going, when the deformation or the vibration occur. So all those very critical experiments, which otherwise would have cost India huge crores of rupees, we would not have taken a design decision on that, had been done with this lab. And that was actually very gratifying that we have been playing a very major role.
So which essentially means you kind of created artificial earthquake situation in your lab. So where all this thing can be tested and then we can be very sure this is what will happen maximum.
Exactly.
That's a very, very interesting.
Exactly. It has been done.
And then we now have a world-class facility in India.
Exactly.
Just because of this.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. So what would you put them as third?
Put them?
Put a third in your list of...
Third one is one of the analytical things that we have done. We have been working on what is called as the spectral finite element method. In any analysis or a computer simulation that you do for elasticity related problems, the finer the mesh size, better the results. And when you typically take a case of what is called as a discrete element, as a beam element or that kind of linear element, you may do irrespective of the mesh size. This actual solution was not very apparent to us. When we started working on this problem on one day on what is called as the spectral finite element method, we thought that actually it is mesh invariant. It is not a function of the mesh. So that gave us a lot of confidence so that a high frequency problem, wherever the excitation is 100 Hz, 200 Hz, as in the case of the blast, as in the case of the impact, where the loading is very transient, it happens for a very short duration, you can analyze these structures. Once we have made this formulation in the computer code ourselves, we were doing at University of Michigan, sitting at that place as a visiting scholar, and that gave me a lot of confidence that certain very critical problems can be solved, analytically as well as experimentally.
Yeah, very interesting. I mean, we got a really very interesting, aspect of your research work, diverse, that's very interesting, from power plant, ensuring that the turbine work, to establishing a world-class earthquake facility, to doing computational analysis. Very, very interesting. We need to take a very short break. We'll take a very short break. Don't go away. We are going to have a very interesting discussion. Close to about 38% of greenhouse gases are emitted from construction. How are you going to solve this? If we have to provide more homes, more infrastructure, how are we going to meet this? We are going to have a very exciting discussion after the break. Keep watching Eureka. Welcome back to Eureka, and we are having a very interesting conversation with Dr. N Gopalakrishnan, Director of Central Building Research Institute, a constant unit of CSIR at Roorkee. Before the break, I presented a major challenge that is there before us. One of the major challenges that this globe is facing is global warming. And close to about 38% of global warming gases, it is said, are emitted directly or indirectly by construction-related industry. But on the other hand, there are a lot of people who don't have homes. I mean, countries like India has to build up their infrastructure, so which means we need to indulge in quite a lot of construction. How are we going to meet this problem?
When, as you have rightly put it forth, there is a lot of elasticity in construction sector. Elasticity, what do we mean by elasticity is this. You need to provide a house for just 1 lakh rupees or 1.25 lakh rupees. You also need to provide a house which is available here for 20 crores in Greater Noida. This is a kind of elasticity. You have a large upper segment. Sitting in India, you have a very, very large lower segment. There are actually, the construction industry has a large magnitude. The volume is extremely large. The value is not large. For a 1 lakh, the value is not large. But the volume is extremely large. Now the volume into value when you put it, this takes a gargantuan amount of the economics of the whole country. Like 10 to 20% of our 1 crore budget, our GDP is 2 crore budget, 2 into 10 power 14 rupees. Nearly 10 to 20% goes into the construction related activities, either it is steel manufacturing or it is brick or whatever. Now, as far as cement is concerned, cement is a very ideal source for concrete. You can't go manufacturing concrete without cement, and the concrete, you can make it at any form. It's almost, as a layman, it is actually like a stone. It comes from the stone, it goes like a stone. And it is extremely good, and you reinforce that with steel to give elasticity to that, to increase what is called the ductility in the system. But the cement that is being manufactured has got a particular two or three drawbacks. One is, it has to use naturally available materials, like it is limestone or if it is clay, And the amount of fuel that goes into manufacturing this in the clinkering process is very large, like 1 ton of CO2. Close to 1 ton is being emitted for 1 ton of carbon, 1 ton of cement being produced. India requires something like 380 to 400 million tons of cement. That actually tells 400 million tons of carbon dioxide is also spewed into the atmosphere. 400 million tons of concrete, 400 million tons of cement actually tells you 5 into 400, 2000 tons of concrete is required. Concrete is a very widely used material after water. That's the statistics. Now, given a material which is actually very good, extremely versatile, you can cast that in any form, you can put it in ocean, it becomes a solid material, you can do it anywhere, make bridges out of that in no time, and the design is robust, well-founded, you need to find out an alternative for the cement.
Yeah.
It's actually not available. Now, what we have stumbled upon, not this institute, but the couple of institutes in this country as well as all over the world, has stumbled upon what is called another material called as a geopolymer, which may revolutionize this particular thing.
Geopolymer. Okay.
The polymer in the conventional system is an organic chain which is continuously made by CH2 bond or some other bond, essentially carbon related. Actually, it has nothing to do with the carbon related, it is inorganic polymer, but it also makes a large number of molecule chain and forms this thing. And it is made up of essentially materials like fly ash or ground granulated blast furnace slag, which are the throwaway material from steel. Right now, they have got a lot of value addition. Fly ash is right now not available to the same extent as it used to be 20 years back because a lot of them have been gone into the cement manufacturers also. That is how you get your pozzolana cement. The left out fly ash is also a big quantity. The left out GGBS also is a big quantity. That can be used along with some other chemicals like sodium silicate and you can make geopolymer out of that. So, this is one of the revolutionizing changes that is happening in…
Let's look at housing. As I started this program by saying that more than about 8 crores of people are homeless. And if you look at people who have poor housing, I mean, the numbers will grow up. Our cities are growing, which essentially means that urban spaces have to be built, infrastructures have to be built. So, in terms of housing, which is one of the major concern of your institute currently, what are the key challenges that we have?
There are actually two different challenges, totally different challenges. One is this upper segment of the population or the middle class of India or the rich class of India, wherein you need to provide a housing. And they don't mind paying something like 2000 rupees per square foot, 2500 rupees per square foot as a cost of construction. Cost of real estate is different. When you add the cost of real estate, it actually grows very large. And the other segment, which is available in a rural area, where you cannot source the material from large distances, locally available material has to be used. And they require houses to be constructed at 400 or 500 rupees per square foot. 400, 500 square feet is a cost which is actually globally very, very low. No country can even dare to think that kind of housing can be really provided. And that is called as a pakka housing, which needs to long last for at least 30 years. That's a kind of thing. So the whole challenge is, for the lower segment, how to take this material, take the local soil, add some cement, make what is called as a compressed clay, compressed stone block or clay block from that, build that. Don't take it from anywhere or make very less use of cement, make some small elements which are the roofing elements, build that. You can still satisfy their needs by building a house in 1 or 1.5 lakhs rupees with a lot of research that has to be gone into that. A lot of research has to go into that so that they don't just get damaged in the kind of a cyclone or if it is an earthquake or if it is a flood or something, they still keep it intact. So, there are many things that have been done in this. For example, a simple thing that has been done in this, for in the case of a flood, you have this flood water coming up to 1 meter or 0.5 meters. The lower portion, which is called as the plinth kind of thing, gets eroded. And right now, what we have added, even in the case of the mud is actually a clay. Clay, you add some kerosene or some kind of material into that, such that it does not get eroded in the case of a flood. That's the lowest intervention possible, very economical intervention. This has been done in this institute. There are very many things like that, which are at the very low level. For example, the thatch. Suppose you have a thatched house. By putting a layer above the thatch, when you put a torch, when you put a flame, the thatch will not catch fire.
Okay. So, you can make it fireproof.
You can make it fireproof. Otherwise, you reduce the air content in that thing, compress it and put a layer above that so that the oxygen thing is not there. It will not catch fire. So these are all the interventions which are actually at a very low level of that, but has made a huge impact in the common man's thing. The other segment that I am talking about is about this prefabricated building systems. Prefabricated building system is essentially a 10-storied house or 20-storied house or at most a G+4 kind of houses. Now, when these houses are to be built, you need to go for normal housing wherein materials are bought, the labor come from essentially two or three states supply the labor, and actually we are exploiting these states that this thing, no other state supplies this. They come, sit there, work in your house, build the house and go away. Now we have a problem. There is lack of quality and we are paying relatively less.
Labor, yeah.
Relatively less. They are also not skilled. We don't work for, we don't need that. They have to be, there is always a HO2 which who learns from his boss how this work is to be done. He does it. There is no proper skill development. So these are all the things that are affecting the building sector. So the natural recourse is only prefabricated building system. So we need to go for prefabricated building system where all these components can be made in the factory. India will come, will receive a particular kind of, will is an imminent time will come for India wherein we'll run out of our unskilled labor. We will not have that labor anymore. And the quality issues will more and more plague this construction sector. So you have no other option except to go for those elements which are manufactured in factory, get assembled in the field.
So that prefabrication is another major challenge that we need to move. It's a very important point, and this is the right time to take a very short break. We'll take a very short break. We'll continue this conversation. Don't go away. Do you know in India, after agriculture, construction is the largest employer. Unskilled, semi-skilled, partly skilled, quite a lot of people are employed in this industry. And what this institute has done in the last 70 years, this is the point that we are going to discuss after the break. Keep watching Eureka. We'll take a very short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to Eureka. So we had a very wonderful conversation until now. We want to ask you a very important question. This Central Building Research Institute is located in Roorkee, formed about 70 years
ago. I'll tell you historically.
Why Roorkee of all the places?
The center of gravity of civil engineering works were located in 2-3 places in India. We had a lot of hydraulic structures which had to be built in this place, Ganga Canal and a lot of things. The first civil engineering school, the Roorkee University is actually called as a civil engineering, Thompson Civil Engineering School, which was established in this place, and a lot of hydraulic related engineering works were being carried out prior to independence as well as after independence. So this was the ideal location amongst few others, like Pune also was another location where water commission was established and all those things. That's the reason this got established, and justifiably so, it has done lot of things. Civil engineering is concerned from this particular lab. One is called, is the under-reamed pile foundation.
Underlined pile foundation,
yeah.
Okay.
Under-reamed pile foundation. Uh-huh. Second one is the pollution control measured for brick kilns.
Okay. Pollution control from brick kilns.
Brick kilns.
People are complaining.
Where they manufacture the bricks.
Okay.
Third one is making bricks from inferior clay soils.
Okay.
Uh-huh. The fourth one will be that two-pit latrine systems, which have also evolved from this. This is one of the few. There are very many actually from this lab. I'm just listing few.
Yeah. So let's look at the first one that you said. Underlying pile foundation. Anybody will know that foundation is nothing but you dig a pit, maybe perhaps put lots of rubble in it. That makes you a foundation, right? So should it be something different? What comes in picture?
The soil actually plays the major culprit in any building performance. The soil, if it is clay content, which is like 20-30 microns down, that's the clay content of the soil, which has come out of the degradation, denudation process of the atmosphere. The small particles that is present in the soil actually can take up a lot of water and swell up. A huge volume. They give the upward
thrust.
Yeah,
it's like those modern day material, no? Which you put in water, then those things bubble up.
Exactly.
And then you take them out of water, they shrink.
Exactly.
So the clay can also expand.
Exactly.
And, okay.
So these are all called as marine clays or expansive soil and these kind of things. they create a lot of trouble. The only foundation that can be used is something looking like a stick, looking like a column, linear element, which is driven into the soil. Now, the regular prismatic linear element of the same area driven into the soil will have only skin friction and will have a very small amount of the bearing.
Okay, so if I put a vertical thing in the mud, only here the friction will happen,
exactly.
And then that's what will
exactly.
hold it.
Okay. Exactly. Now, we have a process by which within this length, you can have a reaming tool, under reaming tool, which will expand, which will create a bulb around this prismatic kind of stick that is coming. Two
okay,
or three
so
places.
So you put it inside and then put something like this.
Exactly. Exactly.
So it's not only that.
Yeah.
Okay, it's not only the skin, but then also the protrusion will also create.
All those protrusions that come out of that is called as a bulb.
Okay, bulb. Okay.
Two or three bulbs can be created, which actually take further additional room.
Oh.
This has been done in the first time in this country. This is ideal for clay soils. It can't be used for sandy soils to a great extent. But this is the first product from India. The India has given this product to the whole world.
Okay. Okay. So the whole world is using the product developed by this CBRI. Forget about just buildings in India.
Exactly.
Right? Okay. Very interesting. Very interesting. Yeah. So second, you said something about pollution control in bricklin.
Yeah. When you make a conventional bricklin, it goes up to around 700-800 degrees of temperature for binding this whole thing, and the clay becomes brick. When you do that, they use only a very inferior kinds of fuels, like which creates a lot of carbon into the atmosphere. So what is being done in this is raising the height of the chimney. Straight away somebody can do that using the brick chimney. Another thing that has been done is what is called as a zigzag kiln. Zigzag kiln is when this exhaust gas, after they have spent out their energy, when they pass through that, they go through a zigzag process such that the velocity comes down. They
pass. So when you burn with about 600 degrees, actually that steam will be really flowing fast, right? Okay, okay. So that's what you want to slow down.
Yeah.
So you make a zigzag path, so when it flows up and down, swirling here and there, the velocity can be reduced.
Yeah,
yeah okay, okay.
The exhaust gases under high velocity carries a lot of particles with them. They go to the atmosphere, they deposit the particles.
So it's something like that. If I have some dust here and I blow, the dust will also flow.
Exactly, exactly.
But if I blow very low, then the dust may not
dust
be able
not
to
go.
Yeah.
So that kind of thing has been introduced, such that the pollution, the PM2.5 and all those emissions that are put into the atmosphere gets reduced.
So which means without actually going for, you know, sophisticated stuff like, you know, electrical scrubber and that kind of stuff. I mean, you can just by designing this, you can reduce the pollution level of a bricklin. Very, 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 very sweet thing, I suppose so. Very cute stuff, I suppose so. And then there's something that can be done locally very easily.
Very easily.
Let me ask you a very, we don't have much time, so let me ask you a last question. We are entering the 21st century. This institute was formed about 70 years ago and the challenges and problems were very different. So how do you plan to reinvent yourself for our new future?
That's a very good question. Now the challenges that existed 30 years back are no more there and we need to shift our grounds. We also need to shed some areas and all those things. Right now our focus has been, as I told you, on the prefabricated building system which comes in the mass housing. We also need to make a lot of ground into the fire protection aspect of buildings. The fire is actually a serious problem. When you go for multi-storied buildings, 10-storey, 20-storey, the fire escape actually is a very serious issue. And all those gadgets which you try to use are more and more electrically driven with AC and other things. You need to have a fire protection and we have a very good lab doing that. We also concentrate on what are called the heritage structures, those old structures which have to be conserved. We create digitally we create those structures by taking the three-dimensional geometry. In case the structure is no more there, you can actually create them back.
Okay.
These kind of things we are looking after. Maybe. We also work on structural health monitoring and a couple of other things.
Very interesting. We had a very, very good conversation in this episode. I'm sure we learned quite a lot. I mean, we understood many aspects of this institute. Many people may not know about this institute directly, but indirectly it has played a part in their life. I mean, it's there in their surrounding. Thank you for watching Eureka. In this episode, we saw how an institute which is located, maybe not in the limelight, but but as I played a very important role in nation building and as a crucial role to play in the times to come. Keep watching Eureka. We'll come back with another interesting episode next week.